We are all live.
Awesome. I love that voice.
We are live. Awesome. Yeah.
Thank you guys for coming. You know, we all, there's a bunch of videos that we have, and I still have to go through a ton of them. I've got all these great, well, to me, they're great. I don't know how many people are here and actually fans of Star Trek. I know there's a lot of people here that just love Sansar and love sci-fi. I have a ton of videos on my father, and there's some great stuff. I just haven't really gone through them all yet. But being a quasi-geek like I am, I go through the internet and I watch, well, maybe not cat videos, but I watch tons of other videos. And every now and then I come across like a Star Trek or a Gene Roddenberry related video. Some suck, but some are really good. And I was unaware, but this comic book girl 19 is fairly well known, at least in the Star Trek community. And she does these sort of informative videos on sci-fi and people that are in the sci-fi arena. And she did one on my father. And I watched it and I was like, this is awesome. This is like for anyone who doesn't know much about Star Trek, or at least doesn't know everything about Star Trek, this is like the perfect summary of everything Gene Roddenberry and Star Trek, in terms of when it started, what's been out, how many series there are, history on Gene Roddenberry. She just sums it up in a beautiful segment. So I thought it would be good to show this, and then those of you who know everything about Star Trek can challenge maybe any facts that she gives out. Those of you who know nothing or little about Star Trek or Gene Roddenberry can ask questions and all that, and I'll be happy to fill in what I can. John is the authority when it comes to Star Trek, really. I would be the authority when it comes to my father, obviously. So, and sometimes John can be the authority on that too, when I don't know certain things. So.
Every now and then. No, every now and really. Then. Yeah.
So if you guys are ready, I'm just going to start the video and we can enjoy.
Cool. All right. I'll run up there and get it going.
Oh, that's right. You have to get it going because
I sure do. Whoa, why am I? Oh, there we go. Okay. All right.
And here I'm going to. Oh, God, I got to learn how to sit down on one of these things. Does anyone know how to sit down? How do you sit down?
Sit down on the floor.
Yeah, that's right. It just works.
Yeah.
You might sink into the floor a bit.
Okay. Ready?
What if I sit in a chair? Does that work?
Not really. I tried
it. Okay. Oh, but if I sit down, I can't get my drink.
Tell the man how to emote in VR.
Right. Okay. All right, you guys ready? Here we go.
Tell the man how to emote in VR.
Right. Okay.
Uh-oh, I stood up.
I'm Comic Book Girl 19, and welcome to Greater Creators. 2016 marks the 50th anniversary of Star Trek. With 7 television series, 13 movies, and countless books and comics, Star Trek has made an enormous cultural impact over the past 5 decades, being one of the longest and most well-known science fiction franchises of all time. I mean, even if you've never seen one episode of Star Trek, you know what Star Trek is. You know what it is.
I've heard of Star Trek.
That's great, robot. Fantastic. You get an A. Gene Roddenberry was the creator of the Star Trek universe, including the original series and Star Trek The Next Generation. The New York Times described Roddenberry as a tall, soft-spoken man with a silver mane and a dazzling imagination. An imagination that inspired fans who went on to create things like cell phones, ion propulsion, and personal computers. Personally, I became a fan of Star Trek when I was a little girl watching The Next Generation with my family. For the first time, I got to see a working model of what emotionally stable adults...
A very important comment for right now.
Through generally talking it out.
Teacher, what all stuff are we gonna learn in this class?
With a loaded baked potato, we're gonna talk about Gene Roddenberry's life history and how he created Star Trek. Then we're gonna talk about a timeline of the Star Trek shows and movies. Also, we're gonna go over my favorite episodes of Star Trek and the legacy that Gene Roddenberry left behind. And the thing that's so interesting and unique about Star Trek, the thing that sets it apart from all of the other science fiction out there, was the fact that Gene Roddenberry didn't have this dark, dystopian, apocalyptic vision of mankind's future. He saw a future where mankind is going to mature, we're going to be seeking out new civilizations, and these ideas broke new ground. Star Trek is about more than fancy futuristic gadgets and gizmos. It's about the future of human society and social evolution. And that's what Gene Roddenberry was really excited to talk about, because he believed that humanity now, as it stands, we're really just children. And in the 24th century, he believes that we could evolve to be more mature. Then we'll be able to get rid of all of these problems that we have now. We'll have a resource-based economy. Material possessions will no longer be the driving force in our lives, and how humans eventually will just work to better themselves without being told
to. That sounds nice.
We did not accept the myth that the television audience has an infantile mind. As a matter of fact, we decided to risk the whole show on that premise. We believe that the often ridiculed mass audience is sick of this world's petty nationalism and all its old ways and old hatreds, and that people are not only willing but anxious to think beyond those petty beliefs that have for so long kept mankind divided.
Now let's talk about the man himself. Eugene Wesley Roddenberry was born August 19, 1921 in El Paso, Texas. He was an avid reader from a young age, with stories like Skylark and John Carter of Mars being among his favorites. Long before he created Star Trek, Roddenberry already lived a pretty interesting and fascinating life. For starters, he was a highly decorated B-17 pilot in the Pacific during World War II. And after the war, he flew some of the longest routes for Pan American World Airways. After hanging up his wings in 1949, he got a job working for the LAPD, where he wrote speeches for the chief of police. In his meantime, he started working on freelance television scripts. And 7 years later, he was able to resign from the LAPD to focus on his writing full time.
Why was he able to resign?
Well, Grain, it was because he got the gig of head writer for a television show called West Point Story. He also worked on a lot of other television shows, such as Dragnet, and he even earned a Writers Guild Award for an episode of the CBS Western Have Gun, Will Travel. Following that, he wrote a bunch of scripts that never really went anywhere. He had a lot of different pitches, and it was from these different pitches that he started to get all his ideas together for Star Trek. In 1964, Gene was ready to pitch Star Trek around town. He first went to MGM, who was very interested, but they ultimately passed. Then he went to CBS, who also passed. And finally, he went to NBC, who picked it up. But NBC didn't pick it up until the second pilot. Gene had to make two separate pilots for Star Trek before NBC was like, yes, we're going to put this in the fall television schedule of 1966. So let me contextualize the times the show was born into. This was 1966, right in the middle of a decade that had some of the most sweeping social changes of all time in America. And Gene Roddenberry wanted to help push those social changes through using the science fiction in his show to explore themes that were going on in the here and now. You had the Cold War, which was lingering on with Russia. You had a war in Vietnam going on, as well as at home, the civil rights and the women's rights movements. So there's a lot of things going on in the 60s. And so now, on top of that, you have this show coming out, which is going out of its way to show a racially diverse crew of people working together in harmony. This was unheard of. You've got a Russian crew member in Chekhov, you have a Japanese crew member, you have a black female crew member, and that was like really unheard of. Gene Roddenberry pushed to have a black girl on the show because the studios did not want her on there, and he finally got his way, thank goodness. They even have a straight up alien on the crew, okay? Like, so not only are humans getting along with themselves, they're also getting along with other races of beings in the universe. In fact, Star Trek is so progressive that it had the first interracial kiss on television, and Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was also a fan of the show, and at one point even encouraged Nichelle Nichols about the importance of her now iconic character of Lieutenant Uhura.
Oh yeah, well, did they do any robot human kisses?
They did in The Next Generation, but that's in the 90s. And it was more than just kissing.
From you, Data, you are fully functional, aren't you?
Of course, but...
How fully? In every way, of course.
That's exactly what I hoped.
What was it?
I'll tell you when you're older. After season two, Star Trek was in danger of being canceled, but due to a massive letter writing campaign where NBC was like getting 6,000 letters a week, plus student protests at the studio, that's how much people loved Star Trek back then, which saved the show for its third and final season. Despite being only canceled after three seasons, the show found new life and a cult following in syndication. And in 1975, almost 10 years later, it was still on the air, and TV Guide called it the show that wouldn't die.
Man, there's so many Star Trek TV shows and movies. How am I supposed to know which one's what and which one happened when?
Well, Robot, don't worry. Here's a brief timeline of the Star Trek shows and movies. It all started with Star Trek the Original Series in 1966 through 1969. It had three seasons, and it follows the adventures of the crew of the Enterprise with Captain Kirk at the helm. Next up, we have Star Trek the Animated Series coming out, and that ran from 1973 to 1974. Now, this show follows the further adventures of the original series crew, with a lot of them coming back to do the voices of their own characters. We didn't get any more Star Trek on television until later on in the 80s, but we did start getting Star Trek movies, starting in 1979 with Star Trek The Motion Picture, which was followed by Star Trek II The Wrath of Khan in 1982, which was followed by Star Trek III The Search for Spock in 1984, which was followed by Star Trek IV The Voyage Home in 1986.
Is this gonna be on the test?
Yes. Now, back on the small screen, Star Trek The Next Generation. This begins in 1987, running till 1994 with a total of seven seasons. And this show takes place about 100 years after the start of the original series, with Captain Jean-Luc Picard at the helm. Now, even though we have a new Star Trek show with a new crew on the air, people still hadn't really accepted them, right? And they still wanted to see the crew from the original series. So, as a compromise, we still get to see the original series crew on the big screen in Star Trek V, The Final Frontier in 1989, and in Star Trek VI, The Undiscovered Country in 1991, with this being the last film featuring the entire crew of the original series. Now, back on television, we have Star Trek Deep Space Nine coming out in 1993 through 1999. It also has seven seasons. In order to differentiate this show from The Next Generation, Deep Space Nine takes place on a space station instead of a starship. Now, back on the big screen, we finally get to see the cast of The Next Generation in their own film, starting in Star Trek Generations in 1994. Although Captain Kirk still makes an appearance, so we have one original series member, but whatever.
Help Warp 1, engage!
We have Star Trek Voyager coming out in 1995, running all the way to 2001, also with seven seasons, and this show takes place after The Next Generation was canceled, but while Deep Space Nine was still airing. Captained by Catherine Janeway, this show follows the adventures of the crew of the USS Voyager, who are stranded on the far side of the galaxy, the Delta Quadrant, some 70,000 light years away from Earth. And all they want to do is get home. So they're just like trying to get back, which would approximately take like 75 years if they were going at like warp 9, so it's a whole thing. In 1996, we get Star Trek First Contact, and this is the first Star Trek film where zero characters from the original series appear. And that was followed by Star Trek Insurrection in 1998. And back on television, we have Star Trek Enterprise airing in 2001 to 2005 with four seasons. Now, this show is a prequel to the original series, set about 100 years before Kirk and his crew. The Star Trek Enterprise follows the adventures of the first Starfleet ship, the Enterprise NX-01, as they are the first Starfleet crew to explore deep space. Captained by Jonathan Archer, this series shows the crew making first contact with a number of alien races, including the Klingons. In 2002, we get Star Trek Nemesis. This is the last Star Trek movie to feature the Next Generation crew before the cinematic reboot starting in 2009. And of course, you probably should remember the Star Trek reboot in 2009, simply called Star Trek. This movie takes place in an alternate timeline and it has the main characters from the original series now portrayed by a new cast, which spawned two sequels, Star Trek Into Darkness in 2013 and Star Trek Beyond in 2016. And now, starting in 2017, we finally get a brand new Star Trek show on television called Star Trek Discovery. This show takes place about 10 years before the events of the original series and is on a separate timeline from the movies being made today. So, like, they're totally separate. This show is set to follow the crew of the Discovery, and I can't wait to watch.
Teacher, do you have any favorite episodes of Star Trek?
Of course I do, Space Brain. Now, I have to be honest here. I'm more of a fan of the Next Generation than I am of the original series, so all of my episodes come from that. One of them being The Measure of a Man. It's all about Lieutenant Commander Data and whether or not he's considered a sentient being with his own rights or whether he's simply property of Starfleet.
Since I first saw Data at the entrance evaluation at the Starfleet Academy, I've wanted to understand it. I believe I am very close to the breakthrough that will enable me to duplicate Dr. Soong's work. But as a first step, I must disassemble and study it.
When a guy comes in and wants to take his brain apart to see if he can make more Data's, and Data's like, well, can you guarantee that this isn't going to kill me? And the guy's like, no. And then Data's like, well, then I don't want to do it.
I cannot allow Commander Data to submit himself to this experiment.
I was afraid this might be your attitude, Captain. Here are Starfleet's transfer orders, separating Commander Data from the Enterprise and reassigning it to Starbase 173 under my command.
And they have to have this whole friggin' trial to figure out whether Data has the right to say no to this guy, potentially killing him, which, thank God, he does.
Is your contention that Lieutenant Commander Data is not a sentient being and therefore not entitled to all the rights reserved for all life forms within this Federation?
Data is not sentient, no.
Commander, would you enlighten us? What is required for sentience?
Another fun one is called the Neutral Zone. And in this episode, we have a group of 20th century men and women who've been cryogenically frozen, and then they're found by the crew of the Enterprise. They're thawed out in the 24th century.
Let's see if the Brave's on. How do you cut on this TV?
TV?
Yeah, the boob tube.
There's no trace of my money. My office is gone. What will I do? How will I live?
And they just, like, cannot handle the cultural changes that have gone on and just don't even know how to deal with the fact that there's no money anymore. It's hilarious.
A lot has changed in the past 300 years. People are no longer obsessed with the accumulation of things. We have eliminated hunger, want, the need for possessions. We've grown out of our infancy.
Then what's the challenge?
The challenge, Mr. Offenhaus, is to improve yourself, to enrich yourself. Enjoy it.
Another one of my favorite episodes is called Family, and this one deals a lot with Captain Jean-Luc Picard. Now, this episode takes place directly after he has been turned and unturned into a Borg, and he's forced to go on a vacation, so he decides to visit his brother in France. And in this episode, we really get to see Picard's humanity more than ever, because we always see him as this very level-headed captain. And for the first time, we see him break down. He gets in a fight with his little brother. He cries. He's like, admits that he wasn't strong enough to fight off the Borg. And man, I wept with him.
They took everything I was. They used me to kill and to destroy, and I couldn't stop them. I wasn't strong enough. I wasn't got it.
So, my brother is a human being after all.
One more episode I want to tell you about is called Who Watches the Watchers? And in this episode, it's all about when the Enterprise accidentally violates the Prime Directive.
What's the Prime Directive?
The Prime Directive pretty much prohibits any Starfleet member from messing around with any, like, developing alien civilization that, like, is not ready for space travel, okay? You gotta be hands-off with these people. And in this episode, the crew lands on a proto-Vulcan Bronze Age-level planet, and they accidentally, like, mess up a guy, and they have to take him on board to fix him, and they try to mind-wipe him, but it doesn't work, and he, like, remembers all this stuff from being up in the spaceship, and he comes back down, and then he gets all his people to start worshiping this god called the Picard.
You must go down to Mintaka 3.
Masquerading as a god?
Absolutely out of the question. The Prime Directive
has already been violated. The damage is done.
Dr. Baron, I cannot, I will not impose a set of commandments on these people.
In 1985, Gene Roddenberry became the first ever TV writer to have an actual star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame.
I will never make a change in Star Trek because I think it will please the Trekkers. In that way lies prostitution. And you cannot be a good producer, writer, or anything if you first thing you ask is, what do they want? That's what prostitutes do. I write what I think they should have.
Teacher, what do you think of Gene Roddenberry's drug use and other unsavory accusations?
Well, Brain, it plagued him throughout his life. And in fact, before they started The Next Generation, he had to go and get cleaned up to get ready for it, all right? He had to do a detox for all that because he really cared and he wanted to get it together. So that's, at least he's responsible about it to some degree. Roddenberry's involvement in The Next Generation lasted through the first three seasons of the show's seven seasons, and he even gave his blessing to the creation of the spinoff Deep Space Nine.
Only three seasons? Why did he do the whole show?
Well, Robot, that's because unfortunately, Gene Roddenberry passed away in 1991 of a heart attack in Santa Monica. Also, the two-part Next Gen episode Unification was dedicated to him.
If you read science fiction, the more you read it, the more you realize that you and the universe are part of the same thing. Science still knows practically nothing about the real nature of matter, energy, dimension, or time, and even less about those remarkable things called life and thought. But whatever the meaning and purpose of this universe, you are a legitimate part of it. And since you are part of the all that is, part of its purpose, there is more to you than just this brief speck of existence. You are just a visitor here in this time and this place, a traveler through it. What a difference that makes. As a traveler here, it no longer crushes you that this world is not always fair or orderly or understandable. Your passport allows you to fix what you can, to love, to refuse to take part in ugliness. But meanwhile, you are delighted that this is such a varied, colorful, exciting place. As a traveler, you're not here to judge, but to experience. You begin to feel a new affection for the life forms here. You no longer feel threatened that some may be greater or lesser than you. It's only important that you've been given this marvelous opportunity to enjoy this trip, to learn from it, and in my case, write about it. Perhaps you know where I'm leading. On a trip like this, and it is a trip, its loveliness is not in the sameness of people and things, but in their incredible variety. Eventually, this led me to the Star Trek statement, IDIC, infinite diversity from infinite combinations. Thank whatever created us, we are different, each of us and everything around us. To the end of time, if it ever does end, no combination will ever come up quite the same. That's quite a travel package. All of this is how Star Trek began. And it's also something of what it's about. I am an alien. And so are you. And yet, and this is the loveliest thing of all, somehow we're also part of each other and part of everything that is.
So what made Gene Roddenberry a greater creator? He was pushing social boundaries of the here and now throughout his sci-fi storytelling. He's promoting tolerance and diversity, that humans are humans no matter what your race, color, creed, or sexual orientation is. He also promoted higher thinking, working together, and showcasing an evolved human race for us to aspire to.
Because it says it's not all over, we're not going to go up in smoke, we're going to make it. Because it says the human adventure has just begun.
Gene Roddenberry stated that Star Trek was an attempt to say that humanity will reach maturity and wisdom on the day that it begins not just to tolerate, but to take a special delight in differences in ideas and differences in life forms. If we cannot learn to actually enjoy those small differences and to take a positive delight in those small differences between our own kind here on this planet, then we do not deserve to go out into space and meet the diversity that is almost certainly out there.
So he believed that aliens really existed?
Yes. Because they do. Because it would be a waste of a universe if there's no other life out there.
Well, I can confirm that they do.
Thanks, Space Brain. But nobody likes to know it all. All right, class, now it's time for your homework. Be sure to watch episodes of Star Trek The Original Series and The Next Generation, recently restored and remastered on Blu-ray. Also, you don't really need to check this one out. Star Trek and X-Men, Planet X. This wasn't as good as I was hoping it was going to be.
Oh my gosh, take it back. That's the dorkiest thing you have.
It is. Yeah, you're right. This is dorkier than the Dune Encyclopedia. They make a holo of Professor Xavier for Picard to talk to because everyone on the X-Men are like, oh my gosh, Picard, you're so much like Professor Xavier. So in the book, it's totally acknowledged. Also, be sure to check out Trekonomics, a book about the economics of Star Trek, exploring the idea of post-scarcity and what a world without money might look like.
A world without money, that'll never happen.
Robot, you just wait 300 years. You just wait and see, all right? Everything's going to be different. You know, I just think about people in the future and, like, them just looking back at us with our stupid little grubby little pieces of paper and our little coins, just laughing at how stupid we are. I think about that all the time.
Tommy,
next time on Greater Creators, where we're going to discuss the works.
Right, John,
of other,
I think you gotta hit the button, buddy.
All right.
There you go.
Oh. Class dismissed. Wait.
We gotta stand up.
Oh, okay. There
that's
we go.
For, yeah.
Yep.
All right. So, is there a way to do a show? Is there a way to do a show of hands? I feel like, Oh, there you go. Okay, so how many of you knew all this? One, I see one, two, three, four. Okay, all right, good. Well, good.
Cool.
I just think Comic Book Girl 19 did such a great job sort of like encapsulating everything in terms of Star Trek and Gene Roddenberry. And I was just impressed. And I figured like with YouTube, we could do other videos. We could do other sci-fi stuff. In fact, tangent. One of the videos I was going to do is, I saw this a month ago. There is a video out there. It's about half an hour. And it's one of these videos that shows, well, it starts at Earth and it shows a timeline. And it's like a 100 years, 1,000 years from the time the Earth was created. And it goes out to like 5 trillion years in our universe and what would happen. So this goes through, obviously, our Earth being absorbed by the sun imploding, the universe turning, everything turning into black holes. It's incredible. Anyhow, it's interesting, but a half hour of sitting here watching that would be a little dry. So I hope you guys are okay with a little Star Trek stuff and Roddenberry stuff. But so did you guys
great.
Find? Yeah, it was. And her, she's witty, and she's got a decent sense of humor, and I like her use of the terrible robot and brain, so. Did you guys have any thoughts or questions or anything you want to say about it or anything else for that matter?
I feel like contradicting her point a little bit about it being the first instance of a really optimistic sci-fi, because it feels like a lot of older ones really were, but they were also sort of more patronizing and simplistic, like what Gene said in that interview about not catering to just what fans want or assuming that they're simple.
Yeah.
A lot of older sci-fi tended to do that, especially on TV. It was just like, let's go shoot the bad guys because we're the Space Force or something.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a good point. I mean, everyone stood on the shoulders of someone else, and clearly there were a lot of optimistic science fiction writers before my father and philosophers before my father. By no means do I think he came up with optimism in science fiction or TV for that matter. But
Star Trek was definitely one of the most cerebral things on TV, pretty much, period.
At that time, absolutely. And I would even argue, in terms of science fiction today, there still isn't that much. Listen, I love the Orville. Orville's freaking phenomenal. if you haven't seen it, it is good. But there's, sci-fi usually takes sort of can often take a darker tone. So even the new Star Trek arguably takes a darker tone. Mm-hmm. That's why I'm a Next Gen fan more than anything. And I'm also an Anson Mount, a Captain Pike fan.
Yes.
Absolutely. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Those of you who have seen Discovery Season 2, he is a true Starfleet captain. And
yes.
And I'm bringing on a spinoff.
If they can't do a TV series, I think the fans would love a series of movies.
With what? Yeah.
With Captain Pike. Do like a movie every 3 or 6 months, you know?
I cannot confirm or deny anything that happened. Let me tell you that there's been a lot of movement out there on the internet in this topic, and CBS... As much credit as I may not always give them, they have not ignored it. Let's
just a reminder, we are streaming live.
Yes. Don't worry.
You just blew up the internet, man.
Well, listen, I'm not saying anything's happening. I'm just saying they don't ignore what happens on the internet. So, you know, people pay attention. And it may not be Pike. It could be someone else.
Mm-hmm.
So, Rod, I saw an interesting video on YouTube. I think it was talking about the reason why we have this kind of JJ-esque discovery is because of a copyright fight that's happening between Paramount and CBS, where, you know, it's, CBS owns the rights to the old Star Trek and Paramount owns the rights to the new Star Trek. So in order for CBS to do Discovery, they sort of had to create this alternate timeline that has a separate copyright. And it was a very interesting theory.
I literally do not know anything about that.
Okay.
Yeah, no, I'm not playing.
Again, merger.
Yeah, no, I mean.
That's why we can't get, you know, a show that, you know, that is truly like the original series because of this argument over the copyright between Paramount and CBS.
If I can just shed a little bit of light on that, if you'll forgive me, Rod.
Oh, jump in, please.
So CBS owns Star Trek. They own the likenesses, they own the characters, they own the look of Star Trek, the name Star Trek. Paramount has the right to the film distribution of Star Trek, which in the recent years, since 2009, has been produced by Bad Robot, by the J.J. Abrams group, you know. So it's not a matter of Paramount owning a slice of the copyright of Star Trek. It's about they have the right to film distribution. CBS has all the rest of Star Trek. So whether it's the original series or Next Gen or Discovery or anything that is to come after Discovery, that is all under the purview of CBS.
Okay.
So there's not really an argument there about who owns what. They're very clear on who has what right, but I think what somebody brought up is this, you know, it's a rumor that's been floated around for quite a while and false starts, the idea of Paramount and CBS coming back together corporately under Viacom, which would be very interesting because then you could actually have movies that would have that would be able to sort of play in the same world a little bit, because right now those movies, since they are separate, you know, in distribution wise, you could actually have a little more, say, cross pollination there.
Well, it's, I mean, but, it clearly just doesn't make sense, at least in terms of Star Trek right now, that one is owned by someone else and one's owned by someone else. I mean, coming from the perspective of what Star Trek should be. It should be together. I mean, bottom line.
Yeah.
In my opinion, I don't think too many people will disagree.
Yeah. Hey, can I ask a really nerdy, nitpicky question? Because we never talk. So, but there was a shot that they showed in the video that was that opening scene from the cage where the camera kind of goes over the Enterprise and into the bridge dome, and then you are there with the live cast. All right.
Yeah.
So in the final episode of Discovery, you had the reverse of that shot.
Right.
You had the camera pull out of the bridge, and then you're there on the hull of the Enterprise.
Yep.
So. Just from an insider production standpoint, had that been something that somebody said early on, like, oh, I know we've got a bookmark, we have to bookend it with this, we have to kind of do this tribute to the cage, was it just sort of like a happy accident last minute thing? Can you shed any light on that?
I mean, clearly it's not a happy accident. There's a lot of people in Discovery who do truly love what Star Trek is and what it represents. And they pay attention to these things. They really do. I, you know, sometimes, so my involvement in Discovery is, you know, I read the scripts, I read the outlines, I send in my ideas, my thoughts. But I am not the one creating it. I am not in the writer's room. I'm not developing it as it happens. But over the last few years, I have gotten to understand that despite the fact that there are hiccups here and there and things that even I may disagree with, people get it. People pay attention. They know what Star Trek is and what it means to people. And they find things like this. They knew where they were going to go with Pike. They knew Pike's, they studied Pike's history. Mm-hmm. They, of course, obviously watched everything. They've got experts who, there's someone who works on the show who actually she used to be an author and she actually knows a lot of the, what goes on in the books. So they throw little, it's not an homage, but they throw little things in like that that fans and myself would really appreciate.
Yeah.
So clearly early on, I don't know when it happened, someone said, oh, let's do this because.
Sure.
And it was beautiful. It's a beautiful bookend, yeah. In a way. So yeah. But yeah, there's a lot of smart people working on the show, by all means.
As good as that video is, there was something that I wish that she had gotten into the biographical details when they were talking about your father's early TV work. She mentioned Have Gun, Will Travel, great show. But The Lieutenant is really the prototype for the types of stories told on Star Trek. So I wish there had been a little mention of that. If nobody here has heard of that before, I think it ran only one season, I want to say. But you had Gary Lockwood, you had Robert Vaughn, special guest stars Nichelle Nichols, Don Marshall. So some Star Trek familiar faces there. But in the context of a contemporary military show, they were able to talk about social issues. And that was the kind of thing that, like with Star Trek, your father would fight to get in these social comments. But it's a lot harder sell when you have to collaborate with the military and you're getting stuff out on network television. Right. Way easier to translate that to the 23rd century.
Right. No, and John, obviously, this is why I'm so happy you're here. John is obviously someone who has studied, well, not like he went to school on it, but he knows quite a bit about this.
John, hey, Rod, sorry. Hey, how's it going? Good to see you.
How are you? Yeah,
good.
And when it comes to Lieutenant and all these older shows that he's probably watched a good chunk of, I've seen clips of The Lieutenant and stuff like that, so yeah. I don't know the story format, but I've learned something from you.
Yeah, it's good stuff. And I think Shout Factory did a home video release maybe within the last 5 to 10 years or so. So it's relatively easy to find. But I would recommend checking that out because you'll definitely notice the Star Trek DNA. And you can probably guess where those moments of frustration were that they would inspire him to go, oh, now we get to really tell this story and really make a statement with Star Trek.
And I think a lot of that happened in Next Generation. Not that he didn't do it in the original series, but I think Next Generation. And it's a weird up-down thing in Next Generation. I mean, there's the, what's the horrible episode that's in season, what, Code of Honor?
Oh, yes. Yeah. Yeah.
So.
Yeah, right. Really? Nice.
Yeah, it's one of those things where I'd love to have really been a fly on the wall, even though I was literally probably on the lot that day. I was 13, and of course, they wouldn't let me into any of the production meetings, nor would I have known. But I really would be curious to know what the discussion was. I know they had a director, and they got rid of a director, but the logic and discussion of like how, not just writing the episode, but then how they were going to portray it.
Right.
You know, we're going to have it's going to be an African American planet, and we're going to have them dressed in these, when I watched it when I was younger, none of it bothered me. Just because I didn't have the perspective on the implications on society and the stereotypes and what they meant and all that. So,
they tried to do too much in that episode. They got the gender issue where I think that's the one where there's an issue of, it's shocking to have a female be a fighter, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
So then they try and throw it into, race, right?
Right.
Yeah. And so they could have done one without the other, and maybe it would have been a little bit better episode. But sometimes that's what happens.
John and Ken, I think they made a really good, I think you guys said this on Mission Log, that in audio form, this is a great episode, or at least a decent episode.
Oh, sure. Yeah. I mean, just writing the recap for that episode where you kind of remove all of the troublesome aspects. Yeah. But, and you know, we've said it many times on the show before, and it really is a rule worth considering and knowing is true, which is that nobody sets out to make a bad show. Ed Wood never set out to make a bad movie, and every episode of Star Trek was a director and a writer and a producer and actors trying to make a script the best that they could make it. So you've got many people in many different departments, the art department, makeup, props, set design, production design, all trying to make this as visually interesting and from a storytelling point of view, make it engaging. And then you end up with a show like Code of Honor, and after 30 years you go, wow, this was maybe not the best use of our resources. You know, it is a bit tone deaf.
Yeah, also, yeah. You know, when you look back on it from today, it does look a little different than what it looked like when it was on there.
Yeah.
I'm wondering how much of that. Yeah.
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 It's just because I think that visually it just seemed like the kind of thing you would see in the 1980s on TV.
Right.
The style, right. The afros or whatever, you know, it was just kind of that thing. And I didn't have the same reaction that a lot of people today had to it. I didn't think it was a terribly great episode.
Yeah. Not back then.
But I didn't think it was a terribly bad episode when I first saw it when it came out.
Yeah.
So that's
important. It's important with criticism and critique of anything. You know, you have to look at it in the time and the context that it was done. But then you also have to address, if we're looking at it now, how does it actually play? The age old question for Mission Log, does it hold up? The story. Yeah. The story holds up. Maybe the points they were trying to make hold up. But as a production, it's just going to be problematic. This is kind of off topic, but similar topic. I was reading recently that Disney is launching their channel, right? Their streaming channel, and they're planning to pull a segment out of Dumbo and not show Song of the South. And you can understand somebody at the corporate end thinking why this is a good idea. To me, it is a much better idea to do what Warner Brothers did years ago on their more problematic cartoons, which is to put a big fat disclaimer up front to say, this would not fly today, but we have to watch these with the understanding of the historical context that they were made. These are artistic and historical artifacts that are worth preserving because that's what the artists at the time wanted. Yeah.
So it's an excellent point. And then let's go back to, listen, guys, I'm not into politics and I'm not going to bring up the Trump name, but still.
Let's go back to
Charlottesville. Let's go back to fuck Charlottesville. Pardon me. Let's go back to the concept. I don't mean fuck Charlottesville, but I mean the statue. The idea of these statues.
The controversy.
Of these statues that represented the people in the South who, whatever.
Yeah.
Half of me feels like, okay, listen, I get the historical value, regardless of whether we agree with the politics or the reasoning or the rationale or the actions of this individual of the past. But then at the same time, and this also goes with the Confederate flag, I understand the argument of it's a piece of our history. We should acknowledge it. Now, I also understand it's a piece of our history that really wasn't something that should represent what America is, and therefore we shouldn't have it propped up for everyone to see. I mean, I'm not doing this to have an argument with anyone. I'm just saying it's good to have these conversations where you can see or try to see both sides of it.
Well, what you're saying though is, I think the point I'm kind of getting at, which is you have to change the context based on the time. So, you know, we're 160 years past.
That gets tricky. That gets tricky.
Yeah, we're 150 years past the Civil War, more than 150 years past the Civil War. So the context of what that stuff meant now is different from what it meant then and in the years immediately after the war. So now from our 21st century point of view, we have to say, like, this was a horrible time. This was a big mistake. Now we get to change the context. And if we're going to keep those things, move them to a museum where you can say,
yes,
here's what was going on then. Here's how times have changed since then. You know, as a guy from Birmingham, Alabama, and with family all over the South, you know, there's no shortage of Civil War statues just out on the side of the road or in a field or in front of a home. And at a certain point, part of me at the time as a kid, you're just sort of desensitized to it. Yep. But I think it's important now to go back and say, maybe what we're calling a hero is not exactly heroic. So let's sort of get that out from this constant public reminder, but recontextualize it. So we're not destroying any artistic value.
We're not
destroying the historical importance, but we are giving it a new life that is actually a bit better understanding for the people who see it. You know, I think it would have been very different for me if you know, 13, 14, 15 years old, seeing this stuff, if somebody had also been able to say, here's why this is a problem. Yeah. You know? Yeah. Yeah. That would have been cool.
It's curious though, 50, 100 years from now though,
yeah,
what today that we might all think, whether it be a hero or at least not have such a negative impact or implication, what might be seen that way then?
I mean,
I don't think this is a good time to represent that.
Well,
getting into like a purely black or white is not necessarily a balanced view. When you gotta like look at both the black and, I mean, not racial, I mean like black and white is in yin yang. You know?
Yeah.
I mean?
Yeah.
I was thinking, oh my God, I'm starting to sound like this is terrible.
Yeah.
Well, no, but you're right. We're terrible at nuance and we're terrible at gray areas. Which, just to circle this back to Star Trek.
Yeah. Right.
That's something that Star Trek is actually really good at. is looking at morally complex issues. And yeah, maybe at the end of an episode you have the very cookie cutter, you know, single right answer to something, but very often you also end up with an answer where you can say, you know what, nobody here is completely wrong, nobody here is the bad guy, the good guy, this is an issue with complexity and nuance that our only best recourse is to try to understand.
Exactly, because you've, in a lot of these cases, you're able to at least understand the quote unquote bad guy's perspective, which gives you empathy and somewhat humanizes the bad guy. And you can at least say, I understand why this person thought this way.
Yeah.
And that's the most important thing that we need today, is that whoever in this room and in this world, wherever we disagree with people, and listen, I'm on a soapbox now because I would love to do this myself more often. To go up to them and say, to truly have a conversation that's not heated through emotion and say, why do you think the way you think? Because your idea is different than mine. And somehow have this understanding where you totally understand maybe how they were brought up and who taught them and their perspectives and now why they see the world the way they see the world or whatever their perspective is.
Sure.
That is amazing. And that is what Star Trek at its best does that.
Can I throw somebody under the bus really quick? I'll do that without permission. Thank you. So when Star Trek Into Darkness came out, it was not to talk trash about the JJ movies. I think Beyond is the closest to the feel of a Star Trek original series episode and story. And I really look forward to talking about that on Mission Log. But Into Darkness, I had a lot of problems with that movie. And Rod was kind enough to invite Bob Orsi over for an interview. And Bob was game enough to do it. And he was a really great sport about it. And we got maybe, 40 minutes into it. And all the sort of niceties and all the normal interview questions had been exhausted. And I was done. And then Ken said something along the lines of, are you sure you're done? Because I think you have other things you wanted to bring up. All right. So now we're just gonna go. And I started to go into it about why Khan and why all the secrecy around Khan, and do we really just need to have Khan? And Orsi says, we're doing Star Trek, and Kirk has to have Khan, just like Batman has to have the Joker. And in retrospect, I mean, this was an interesting conversation. I really would love it if people would go back and listen to that interview. Yeah. But in the months, days and months and years since, I kept thinking, there's 750 hours of Star Trek. Mm-hmm. Khan occupies 3 hours of that, you know? And I thought the other things that Kirk or Spock or McCoy, anybody has to deal with is also, you know, an alien probe that's just trying to communicate, or, aliens that are just trying to find their way home. You know, there's all these other things that Kirk or Spock, quote unquote, needs for it to be Star Trek. And Khan just seemed like a really easy answer to that, just because it was popular.
Well,
you know?
John, it could have been worse, you know. That scene that scene in the brig with Benedict Cumberbatch could have kind of unfolded, and he says, I am Finnegan.
Then I would have walked right out. I would have walked right out of the theater. Yeah. But remember, he goes, I am Khan, and the music swells, and the reaction should have been, who? Okay. Because that literally should have no bearing on anybody in that timeline at all. No, nobody should know who he is or care. Mm-hmm. Or care. He could have said, my name is Bob.
Yeah. I enjoyed the second movie. Yeah, of course. Yeah. It was.
Bingo. My name is Bob.
But I enjoyed that movie, and it was no. Yeah. I was just saying I enjoyed it, and I understand that it was that they duplicated a lot, and it was I call it an homage, call it whatever it was to the Wrath of Khan.
Right.
Well, still, agreed, and it might have been a little bit of a safe bet in terms of a story, which may have backfired for some people.
Sure.
It wasn't just Khan in it, though. I mean. So I went to this movie, I saw it for the first time with my friend who had never seen Star Trek II, didn't see a lot of Star Trek. And I didn't really when Cumberbatch said, I am Khan, not a really big deal. When it got to the scene with Kirk in the reactor room and where he was saying things like the ship out of danger or what, yeah. I don't know. It was too similar to Spock's death scene from Star Trek II. Yeah. That's when in the theater, I was like starting to groan out loud. and my friend was like, what's going on? What are you doing? You know? And he didn't understand why, cause he hadn't seen it. But other than that, I mean, it was a movie.
But
failure.
That's the thing. Yeah. That part didn't bother me as much because it was so obviously what it was. And it's like when I go to a movie and it's for me, it's all about managing your expectations. And when I know this, what they're doing with something, I know they're doing sort of this, again, I don't know a better word for it, but this homage, they're kind of doing this shot for shot, or at least really kind of playing it up in terms of what happened in Wrath of Khan. I'm willing to accept it, and I go along with it. What bothered me the most in that one was, Into Darkness, was, so they have this dark side of the Federation, yeah. And they've got this bigger, badder starship.
Right.
And that was just sort of like, right. Anytime someone takes the idea of the United Federation of Planets or Starfleet and says, but there's this sinister side to it, there's this dark side, and I understand maybe it's just a small piece of it.
Right?
Section 31 over that other big...
Yeah, but I understand that no organization is perfect. I'm willing to kind of go with that. But it just, for me, I love the idea behind Star Trek. I love that idea of a better future. I think we all gravitate and say, wouldn't that be great? Anytime we have a representation of that, of the negative side of that, it brings us back to a little bit of who we are today and takes me out of that hopeful future. So when I see that and then oh, it's got to be a bigger battleship. It's just sort of like, oh, okay.
Yeah.
So that was my only issue. It didn't destroy the movie for me. It was just sort of like, mm-hmm. Okay, you know.
Right.
But I have that problem.
Yes.
Speaking of Section 31.
Wait, what was that?
I was traumatized when they blew up Vulcan.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that was a big one for sure.
That was a Vulcan or Romulan?
Well, they blew up Romulus in the first one, then they...
Both,
Vulcan, yeah. Vulcan
of course.
Yeah, yeah, okay. Using the red matter, yeah.
Now, is it just me, or does it seem like they spent the last few movies just trying to remake Star Trek II? I mean, every Star Trek movie that we've had since Generations has been like... bad guy with super weapon out to take revenge, you know?
Yeah. I mean, to me, that just sounds like part of the problem of making a feature movie where all the stakes have to be higher. All the villains have to be badder. And I kind of, you know, there's something about going from the quote unquote failure of Star Trek, the motion picture, where everybody goes, okay, well, we'll make another movie, but we're cutting the budget in half and we're giving it to the TV division. And it's going to be Harv Bennett, because he can bring in a show under budget and on time. And, you know, I feel that way about a lot of things. I'm a huge James Bond fan, and I get uneasy whenever I hear the producers say, well, this one's going to be even bigger than the last one. I'm like, no, it doesn't have to be. Look at Die Another Day. Please, that's what happens when you make it bigger and throw more money at it. It's a disaster. scale it down, scale it back, which they did very well with Casino Royale. It was a much more intimate movie, much more character driven, and I feel like it holds up better.
Though. It was definitely a different kind of Bond.
Yeah.
And on some level, Star Trek's got so much history behind it. I wonder, and I haven't thought through all the way, but if they're damned if they do, if they're damned if they don't. If they did a movie that was about exploring and finding a new planet and solving, well, they've done that, but if they did more of a TV episode version of a movie, would people just sit here and be saying like, well, that's just a TV episode? I love the idea. Right. I do think Casino Royale is a great example because an aspect of it was truly different from everything else.
Yeah.
You know, and so it would be neat for Star Trek to do something completely different. I would argue Discovery is on some level that they're doing that, not just by the format of the show going over 13 to 15 episodes.
I really appreciate what Discovery has done or accomplished so far, even though I swore up and down if it was going to be like another like Doctor Who in space with time travel. Ever since The Voyage Home, Star Trek has been like time travel. It's like, but
yeah. That's sort of a plot device that feels like they've gone back to the well too many times on that. It's interesting though about Discovery. Discovery by the measures that it needs to be for CBS All Access, it is a hit. It is a profitable show. It is a hit. By the measures that they needed, which is very different from the network TV model of what constitutes a hit. It would not have survived on network TV, but where it is, it's doing very well. But it also is produced on the scale of a feature film. I mean, from seeing the pilot, the Battle of the Binary Stars, seeing that pilot two-parter on a big screen held up perfectly on the big screen, and seeing the last two episodes of the last season holds up beautifully on a big screen. I still wonder and think, like, do they even need to do that? Now, fortunately, there's more Star Trek to come. There's animated and there's Picard and everything else that should come after that. Yep. But I think they've kind of proven to themselves, like, well, it's already a hit. It's already profitable. We could even scale it down and tell some more intimate stories and not have to worry about doing the biggest space battle ever seen on TV. You know, to me, it was fine, but it was a little distracting at some point.
That's a good point. I honestly don't know much about the budgets because I know there is a lot going on behind the scenes in terms of different ideas and potential different shows and shorts and all that.
Sure.
And then the animated and stuff that's getting announced left and right. But I haven't really, it's a good question. I don't know where the budget is on these things, but I haven't heard anyone argue about we need to cut it back. I also haven't heard anyone say we need to spend as much as we can on this.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's not even a point of saying we need to cut it back. It's just a point of saying like, well, the audience is there. The audience is tuned in. You can, because it's TV, you have the flexibility of telling more intimate stories, different types of stories, and you're not having to bank it all on the summer blockbuster. You know, you're not having to bank it all and say, well, we have to have the big villain, we have to have the big battle. You know,
that is an excellent point. I mean, I think that's a great point. Period. I mean,
guys, you're going to be producing some upcoming Star Trek. Okay, I think we just heard it right here. So.
No, I really do. Some of the more intimate stuff. So we've been sitting here talking, and we appreciate everyone's input. But you guys, additional thoughts, questions, ideas?
I have a question.
Wait, who?
All right.
I'll see you. Adele. Awesome.
Hi.
You know, because who discovered the warp drive? What species, man? Because I thought it was Bajorian scientists, man. And I'm just trying to figure out when we'll have the warp drive in real life.
Well, Zephyrin Cochran, right?
Yeah, it's from Cochran.
Zephyrin Cochran in I don't know what year, but after World War III, sadly.
Was it 2160?
Really?
No, yes. not 20.
2063.
There you go.
2063.
That soon?
Yeah.
So you're saying when it really becomes 2063.
Yeah.
We're going to look at ourselves and be like, where the hell's warp trap?
Pretty much.
Yeah. So, what happened?
I can't wait either. I'm with you.
So what happened was World War III happened, and so it, he had that, he had been working on it, I guess, and he put it into a Titan missile and right. built a ship in Montana out of a bunker, which was, I guess, away from the radiation, and that's how it happened. So, you know, that's what I've always wondered about this, is we often think when we watch this, where is the connection between us and when it's going to happen for real?
Yeah.
And I just sometimes feel, when I talk to people about it, I feel like sometimes you have to go down to go up. It's a sad thought. But that's kind of the way it was written. Let's
avoid World War III.
If we can do that.
Unfortunately. Isn't like our cell phones like our communicators?
What about those?
The cell phone is like a communicator. I like to take selfies, but, you know, it's kind of like a communicator. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it is. Absolutely is. Yeah.
There is a great book that you may or may not have read called The Making of Star Trek by Stephen Whitfield. And what I'm saying here is that when my father started doing the original series, he would talk to people at Caltech and JPL, and in terms of the technologies, he would say, sort of, so he would say, what we need, for example, like a weapon here, non-lethal, what would you suggest? And they would have, he would have a scientist respond and say, well, we have lasers, but what we're working on is a phasing laser. And so they, you know, that's where the phaser came from. I don't know if that itself is a true story, but I remember reading things mm-hmm. like that. And it talks about the genesis of a lot of these ideas, including the communicator. So if you're interested in that sort of stuff to find out sort of where it came from, that's definitely one to check out.
Yeah, for sure.
So
yeah.
Replicators anytime now.
Yes. Right. Weren't they invented? Didn't they invent it the last year, I thought? Or
the replicator?
Couple months
they
ago.
Transported a photon of light.
I don't know what that means, though.
You know?
Okay, but here's the thing. So the replicator, which really is the key to the, the
everything.
The change in the economy of Star right. Trek, you know. But in the original series, it wasn't the replicator. It was the food synthesizer. Yeah, it was the food slot. So it was like sort of like an automat. You know, there's some big vat of goo in the back that just sort of gets formed into a turkey sandwich and into an apple and whatever. You know, so it takes like another 100 years before you get to the replicator beyond that.
Soybeans and 3D printing.
Yeah, well, that, exactly. Yeah, so that's closer to the synthesizer. You have a vat of goo, in that case, the soybean paste, and then the 3D printer says, oh, look, it's a hamburger. And you're like, no, it's soybeans. So they, no, seriously, it's a hamburger.
With hamburger flavoring.
Yeah, right, right.
That's good.
Oof, food cubes are my favorite.
Oh, weren't they the best? Yeah, yeah, they really were.
Marshmallows or something?
No.
You know, we'll make sure we'll serve that next time we have a screening. We'll have blue cubes of goo.
They would cut up apples into cubes and dye them with food coloring for the original series. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm sure Sansar will love that request. We have to make what?
All right.
Roddenberry asked for what? Blue cubes of what?
And they have to send them to us ahead of time.
There you go.
Yeah, right, yeah. Right. Yeah.
One easy way to get kicked out of Sansar.
I know. Nah, they'd never do that to you.
What's up, David?
Oh, no, I was messing with my controls. No.
Oh, okay. I think, are we at time? Or?
We are, but the dancing eggplant is just like...
That's pretty great. Yeah, wow. Look at him go.
Playing with fire, fire.
I love it. Now, do you have a question?
Yeah, what's up?
No, are you dancing?
Oh, all right. Wait a minute. Okay.
Well,
my God, look at that. Wow.
Be careful.
I'm so high. Hi.
We're going to turn the lights down, and we're going to call this the after hours.
Yeah, right.
Remember, infinite diversity and infinite combination.
That's right.
Even if it's delicious food.
Yes.
Well, guys, I mean, I guess, you know, the only thing to say in closing is to find us, find our shows at podcast.roddenberry.com and Roddenberry at large at roddenberry.com and on Facebook at Roddenberry. What else?
The Mission Log fans here, just please know that it's going to come back soon. These guys haven't had a break in 6.5 years, and we're actually taking some time. We're figuring out.
You guys need a break.
Well, not only that, these guys, we've been talking about a lot of things for years, and this has given us the chance to actually sit down and try to figure out how we want to really plan out the rest of this. So
and the podcast network as a whole, and we're still doing the live show, because the live show is a lot lower time commitment, so we are still doing that Tuesday nights 7 o'clock Pacific on Facebook Live, facebook.com/missionlogpod. Please come if you haven't done that, because that's a lot of fun for us.
I've been there.
Call in.
I have a super advanced announcement that I feel like we can say here because it's a small group and all that. So one of the things that we do at the Roddenberry Podcast Network is we develop new shows, and that actually takes a lot more time and thought to really try to come up with something that you guys will think is interesting, that we think is interesting. But what we also do is we try to find other groups out there that create thought-provoking content and deserve to be recognized, I think, by a larger group of people. And not only that, we want to associate the Roddenberry name with them because we think their work is so good. So I was introduced to a podcast called Shabam, and it is a phenomenal podcast. It's people might inaccurately describe it as a podcast for kids. The science is phenomenal. I've listened to it twice. It's a scripted content show that has narrators that explain science along the way. And not to give too much away, but it's already out there on the internet. What I'm trying to say is we've partnered up with them. They're going to come on board as a Roddenberry podcast, and you guys have got to check them out. They take the scenario where they take the science of, what if there was a zombie situation? What if zombies were real? How would that happen scientifically? And they go into the science of the human body and disease, and what kind of disease it would take to affect the human body in a similar way of that. And then they play out a story of a family that where this has happened in their neighborhood, and how they have to survive and use science and solar panels and all that to make calls, and then how to get in the car. It is awesome. So well done that I encourage you guys all to give it a listen. We will be sort of announcing it soon. We will be doing it sort of one episode at a time so we can all sort of listen to it together. But it is so good that I think you should just go check it out now. It is great. So we're really proud to have them on board.
Yeah. All right.
Oh, yay.
So, cool, guys.
Cool. Yay. Guys. Yeah. Yeah. Shabam.
Shabam.
Shabam. Shabam.
There'll be more time at the office, more time on the systems, so it'll happen.
So just to give you guys a little background, so the thing that was going to happen, White Room, the 360, we're going to be doing that. It was a technical hurdle. It was actually also a logistical hurdle in our office to try to find the right file format. And then we were trying to figure out how to do it in here. But we will be showing a 360-degree film in here in the coming weeks to months.
Nice.
Yeah.
It's something.
But imagine, you know, standing there in the middle, and then exactly. The movie is 360 degrees around this.
We'll all
area.
Have to get in the middle of the circle. Yeah, and then, yeah.
It'll
and
be
then
cool.
That'll
watch
be
it.
Amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So,
oh.
That'll be fun.
Yeah. It'll happen. Cool. All right, guys.
Thank you very
thank
much for
you
coming, everyone.
You're all thank awesome. You. So good to see you all.
Thank you.
Good night,
good
everybody.
Bye.
Until next time. Bye.
Thank you, everybody. This has been a great turnout.
What?
Well said.
We had
two captains.
I saw it. I was not pleased.
Oh, I thought it was pretty cool.
Somebody drop a portal and let's go dance.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, where are we going, Diva?
Where can we dance? What is like
how
spacey?
Is
where are we heading from here?
Spacey.
We need to lay in
we can
corners.
Go to
oops.
I have an experience, but it's not spacey.
Just
do it. Do it, Lacey. Do it.
All right. Let's
do it.
Finish it.
What?
All right. I got a couple
finish
minutes.
Him.
Don't ask him.
I won't finish anything, but here we go.
Yeah, we're gonna go to mine and go to zero gravity.
Nice.
Nice to meet all.
I don't know if I'll fit in that portal.
Hi, Ernie.
Oh, I'll make it fit. Wait, what?
Where are you?
What?
Wait, what?
Calm down. Calm down.
Can I go first, sir? Ladies first.
Yeah, ladies first.
Thank you.
Here, you just gotta give him a little push.
We're gonna go dance.
Yeah.
Every night. You love dancing. This will be fun.
Yeah. Yes, I do.
Wild and free. Night you gonna come? Find a bar. Let's go, Worthy. Commander Riker? Tequila? Carpe that fucking DM? I guess. Ooh, F.
I guess F-kin? We go.
Don't know how to say that. All right. Thank you, Twitch, for joining us. We're going to go dance now. You can watch us dance, but I will be ending the stream soon. All right, Josh, let's do this.
Okay.
Trying to find this real
what,
quick.
What, the Deathcore version?
No, Nightcore.
Nightcore.
Where's the music?
The heck is Nightcore?
I'm trying to find it.
I like
your
fairy
avatar.
Is
a different thing.
Nightcore
is really a thing.
Yes.
Where is the
You're scaring me.
I'm just asking you a question.
Oh my God, Galileo.
It's
I'm not mad. I'm just disappointed.
Fairy.
That's what my parents tell me.
May I ask you a question?
Just kidding. Oh my gosh, I'm trying to...
Why is your voice so small?
What?
I will eat you.
Your voice
you
so small.
Normal size, Lacey.
What? I gotta do normal
you?
Size?
Going like this or
yeah, it's not a bad thing.
Oh.
Oh, okay.
Let's try this. Oh my gosh, it really is not want me to play this.
I get a little saucy sometimes.
Give me a sec. What?
Let's
go, Commander. Here we go.
This one time at band camp.
This one time at band camp.
What did you do to the egg?
Is it possible to get fully rigged? This is one time in Sansar.
This is amazing.
Yeah, I need a poetry turn, record. Turn so your leaf and cough.
Turn your leaf and cough.
I have to go on a human form just to sit down.
Oh. You did this to yourself, Galileo. I have no sympathy.
What did I do?
The eggplants.
He did, didn't
he? Did
he? Yeah.
I just thought people would respect my wishes.
No, never.
No, man, you challenge creators, it's on.
Oh, I can't hear the video for some reason.
Oh, I can't hear it.
Oh, you can turn up your experience.
Oh, it's back on.
Here we go. I got it.
Depeche Mode.
This is.
Yes.
I'm Depeche Mode. I was just talking about them, man. Death Cat.
What were you saying about Depeche Mode?
Here we go.
The music that they were listening to in this other experience, man, is sounded like Depeche Mode. The 80s goth stuff, the pop
yeah.
music.
Yep. Yeah. Like the Cure.
Your own No, Jesus. No, sorry.
Yeah.
That's my jam, big.
I can see my hands in first person when I dance. That's weird.
Hilarious.
I love this song.
Now we're officially breaking rules on the stream.
Are we on the stream right now?
Yeah, you're streaming right now.
I figured that the accidental F-bomb might have been...
Wait a minute, we're streaming still?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, it's definitely not on the stream. I'm gonna try and find this...
Everybody's terrified of streaming.
I look like the bride of ravioli.
I have to go behind the stage and hide now.
Ryusha, I'll find you.
The mini bride of mini ravioli.
I need to go change my clothes. I'll be right back.
Yeah, man, get comfortable.
Why are you talking to me?
Oh, man. Hi, Twitch. You're going to watch me change my clothes. I hope you're excited for this. What should I wear? I'm going to a party.
I guess.